People of Oxford Presbyterian, welcome to your church this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. If you have not already ordered your sub sandwich from the youth group following worship today, I'll share some of mine with you. So I hope you've been able to do that, and if there's still an opportunity for the multiplication of the loaves, come find out. Come find out. I invite you to look at the very back page of the worship booklet, where there's an important question. When I arrived here as interim pastor several months ago, I asked, would you be willing to help me and participate with me in this interim journey of learning about the church's next chapter? I said, would you help me? And you said,
yes.
Are you still saying yes? Good. So you have an opportunity in multiple ways to say yes by responding to this question, where is God calling us to deepen the practice of our faith? During the Lenten season, beginning with the first Sunday of Lent, February 22nd, we will begin a focus in worship in small groups on practices of faith. What does it mean to be a church and a people where radical hospitality is practiced, where we engage in passionate worship, where we embrace the call to intentional faith development and discipleship, and where we say yes to risk-taking mission and service and practice an extravagant generosity, sharing with how God has blessed us in so many ways. You'll see an opportunity to engage in that on multiple levels. Each Sunday, I will be preaching about one of the themes, and then in the coming week, there will be small groups at various times as listed here. And then each individual, in the event that you're not able to participate in a small group, you still will be able to have the opportunity to buy one of the 40 Days of Lent devotional guides for each day of Lent, an opportunity to read a brief reading, focus on a scripture, and then be prepared for that theme in the coming week in worship. So, in effect, there's a way for everyone to participate. And what we are looking for is your participation so that we can begin asking, what is the Spirit of God leading this church to learn and embrace, and how are we called to be growing in our own practice of faith? So I hope you will consider that. Stop by the Molyneux Lounge, and you'll be seeing our logo here all around the church. It's on the back of the bulletin there, and hope you will prayerfully consider participation. Let us prepare to present ourselves to the God who has made us. Thank you.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. Thinking we know all the answers, yet wondering if we haven't missed something.
We enter the sanctuary of truth.
In the company of sinners and saints,
we gather as God's people.
Standing by folks of deep, abiding faith, seated with those who stumble through the kingdom,
we lift our praise to God.
It's very simple. All God asks is that we recognize our sin and acknowledge it. And why? When we offer our prayers of confession, God takes them from us and fills our hearts with such an abundance of mercy, we cannot hold it all. So join me as we pray together, saying, God, our God, we fill our souls with the empty sounds of our culture, and wonder why we are so empty when we need words of hope, of grace, of comfort. We are careful to follow the prescriptions of our doctors give us, yet pay little heed to your hopes for us. We puff out our chest over what good people we are, yet do not notice how our pride trips those who seek to follow Jesus. Forgive us, Holy One, and be gracious to us. Astound us with your words, so we may learn your ways. Nourish us with your mercy, so we may be filled with life. Enter our empty souls, till they overflow with praise for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Of all the astounding works of God, this may be the most wonderful. God is gracious and merciful to each and every one of us. What has this to do with us? Everything. What is this? Good news of the very best kind. We are forgiven. We give thanks to our God with all our hearts. Amen. Thank you. Please stand for the sharing of the peace. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Share the peace with your brothers and sisters this day.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Come on up here. La-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Hi, you guys. I'm going to come over here to my partner, Katie. You can have those. Thank you. Guess what today is? Anybody know? What?
Yes,
Super Bowl! That's right! And guess what? My team is not playing in the Super Bowl. Yeah, you know what this is? You guys can say it. Cheesehead! That's right. So who's... Yes. That's right, all right, at least people know. But you know what? Even though my team didn't make it, I still get to participate because my partner's gonna tell us why. Thanks, Katie.
It sure is.
A long, long time ago, almost 15 years ago, I was in school. And way back then, even then, Miss Pruitt led us in something called the Super Bowl of Caring. And it's a little bit different, because it's S-O-U-P-E-R, meaning that today, while we fill our plates with wings and those freshly made subs and those pickles that we can smell all throughout the church, there are people who don't have those wonderful things to fill their plates. And today, we are going to have a competition between Seahawks fans, Patriots fans, and we'll find some place for those Bengals and Packers fans too. Seahawks fans, you will have this bucket, and we're going to see if you can raise more money than the Patriots fans who have this bucket. Come on, Seahawks fans. So, we are going to be superheroes by filling these soup pots. And Miss Carol is going to teach us another way to be superheroes.
But I need you guys to come down here.
One of these days, you're going to get to go to camp. I hope. Have you been camping? All right, well, let's face everybody out here, because we're going to learn a prayer and teach them too. So, everybody line up here. That's really good. This is called the Superman Prayer. Are you ready? You're ready, almost ready, aren't you? Only this time we're going to start like this. Ready? Put your arms up. And here's the first part. Thank you, God, for giving us bread. And the second part. Thank you, God, for giving us friends. For the bread we eat, for the friends we meet. Thank you, God, for giving us food. Can you do it? All right, here's what we're doing.
Let's do it this way. Okay, everybody up. Arms up. Thank you, God, for giving us friends. Thank you, God, for giving us friends. For the friends we meet, for the friends we meet. Thank you, God, for giving us friends. We
all win. So, who wants to get in the circle? I saw people are ready for it. Come on in. Come on in. There you go. Right over left. Right over left. Right over left. Da-da-da-da-da. Da-da-da-da. Okay. There you go. Got it? Got it? Because no matter
who you are,
no matter
what you do,
you are always loved. Everybody?
By God!
Amen. Let's tell everybody now. Twist on out of there. There you go. All right. Thank you, God. Now, do you guys have a blessing for the congregation?
Yeah. Tell them.
Well, they can say, oh, yeah, but we're allowed to reverse it. You can say it first this time.
May God be with you here.
May God be with you here.
And now they can have a turn.
May God be with you here.
All right, we're mixing it up a little. It's all good.
Please join me in the responsive prayer for illumination. Let us pray. Holy and awesome God, your Son's authority is found in integrity and living truth, not in the assertion of power over others.
Open our imaginations to new dimensions of your love as we listen to your healing words and heal us of all that severs us from you and one another. That we may grow into the vision you unfold before us. Amen.
The first reading today comes from the 18th chapter of Deuteronomy, starting with the 15th verse. The Lord your God will raise up from you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, If I hear the voice of the Lord my God anymore, or ever again see the great fire, I will die. Then the Lord replied to me, They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded that prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.
Gospel lesson today is from Mark's Gospel. Hear then this reading of the good news. Jesus and his followers went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and started teaching. The people were amazed by his teaching, for he was teaching them with authority, not like the legal experts. Suddenly there in the synagogue, a person with an evil spirit screamed, What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One from God. Silence, Jesus said, speaking harshly to the demon. Come out of him. The unclean spirit shook him and screamed. Then it came out. Everyone was shaken and questioned among themselves. What's this? A new teaching with authority. He even commands unclean spirits and they obey him. Right away, the news about him spread throughout the entire region of Galilee. The good news. I'm told that Jesus is asked 183 questions in the Gospels, but he only answers three. That's a striking statistic, isn't it? So often we think religion is about providing quick answers that offer comfort. But read the Gospels, and quite soon you realize Jesus asked questions, lots of questions, actually good questions. Unnerving questions occasionally, realigning questions when our lives are out of alignment with God and God's kingdom. Transforming questions. In fact, one student of the Gospel finds that get this, Jesus himself asks 307 questions. That's an amazing number of questions. And every now and then in the gospel, someone asks Jesus a question with some real depth. Today's gospel is that rare example of an enduring question we ourselves might wrestle with. So let's pray. Gracious God, so often we would like clear answers, and yet you pose questions to us that help us plumb the depths, not only of who we are, but also of who you are and what your intentions are for us. In your name we pray, amen. I wonder, what was it like for those worshiping in Capernaum that day when Jesus taught and did so in an unforgettable way? Because the worship service got going, he read the scriptures, everybody was listening, they said that he had a teaching style that was marked by authority, and then what does Jesus go and do? He picks a fight. I don't know too many preachers who do that in the midst of worship. Occasionally, I guess we might do, but how long would we last if we pick very many fights? But here in this story today, Jesus picks a fight with someone who has an unclean evil spirit. Go figure. Jesus taught, we hear, in such an unforgettable way that not only was his teaching memorable, it had some power. It changed someone's life, and the man who had the encounter, who had the fight, the struggle with Jesus, posed the question, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" What a question. All who were there that day took the question and in some ways I think made it their own. I wonder, is that maybe the question for us here today, also for this church? What does Jesus have to do with us here at Oxford Presbyterian Church at this moment in time in its life? Now, I've been around Presbyterians a lot. We don't often ask that question. What does Jesus have to do with us? I wonder, what would it be like for us as a people of faith if that question were front and center in all that we seek to do and all that we are called to be? What do you have to do with us, Jesus? The synagogue was full that day in Capernaum when Jesus entered. So full the children were crowded, Carol, in a back corner. They didn't get to be up front like we do here. They were put in the back corner like I was when I was 4 or 5 years old because they were afraid I or we would create a disturbance in worship. You ever had that experience? Where can we put these children so they won't create a disturbance? Their mothers were back there in the corner of the synagogue sanctuary that day, and as my grandmother used to do when I visited her country church, they put a quilt down in a big wide open space and they asked all of us kids to play there. It didn't work. So, you know how it is when children make too much noise in worship. But you see, it's really hard for young children to listen when all there is are words, 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 and more words. It's hard to pay attention to words. Because you see, children's bodies want to do something, don't they? Thank God Carol knows that. They get to do something when they're invited forward. And maybe that's something we have to learn from children, that maybe our bodies want to do something too when we encounter the presence of God. I mean, think about it. At times, when you've heard so much about what Jesus wants us to do and intends for us to do and wishes we would do and ask why we aren't doing it, at the end of all that, part of me wants just to say, let's get out into the world and build something when everyone else in the world is tearing it down. I want somebody to put a hammer in my hands, although that's a very dangerous thing, Prue. Definitely no power tools. But I want to go out into the world and build something when I hear all this talk about Jesus wanting us to love and serve and make a difference in the world. See, children get that right. Our bodies want to do something. With Jesus in the synagogue that day, something happened along these lines. Young Barnabas, I can imagine, age 9, joined the parade of children just like we saw today, came up forward when Jesus invited the children to come forward, because Jesus did something a little different. He says, don't prevent the children from coming to me, for such belongs the kingdom of God. And Barnabas was paying attention enough to know that he wanted to come close. And so he did, because he knew in the encounter with this living Jesus that he met the depths of love in a way more real than he had ever experienced. And later on in Jesus' ministry, Barnabas would come forward again. I can imagine after that first day when Jesus was teaching by the lakeside and there were some 5,000 people there who came out to hear, and they forgot to order their sub sandwiches. And Barnabas was the only one who brought his picnic lunch, 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he brought it up to Jesus because his body wanted to do something. He wanted to offer something, and Jesus accepted this gift. And what did Jesus do? He blessed it and broke it, and there was enough for everyone to share. I wonder about that. I got questions about that. Can you imagine living in a world where no one needs to be hungry? That question crosses my mind. Can you imagine living in a world where when we share what we have, miracles are possible? Can you imagine living in that kind of world? And I wonder, what miracle would you like to see happen here in this church if we pulled what we had of our resources and said, God, take what we have, multiply it, and use it? What would you want to see change? What miracle? Imagine if we live faith that way, that miracles may be possible. That man in the synagogue had it right. What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? There was also a woman at synagogue that day named Esther. All through the years, Esther had faithfully served her family and her friends. She was a key figure in the life of the church and service. She was a good woman, a woman of integrity and strength. But Esther had also suffered greatly. You see, her son, the joy of her life, had been filled with life and energy, bubbling over with practical jokes, always making her laugh, a hard worker, but he had been killed by the Roman authorities because he longed for freedom from Rome for his Jewish people. He longed for freedom from Roman rule because the poor had less and less and the rich had more and more, and it kept accelerating that way. The poor had less and less and the rich had more and more. Does that sound like a familiar story? And he wanted things to be different. And he paid for his work to make things different with his life. After a secret meeting one night, Esther's son was arrested, put to death as a troublemaker. And since then, her friends had kept their distance. You see, in times of trouble, maybe you know this too, in times of trouble, don't you find out, especially when things are difficult in times of trouble, that then you find out who your friends really are? Am I right? As one dear lady friend of mine said in a church years ago, Pastor Hart, this is how you know you have a friend. When trouble comes, friends enter your life, and those who are not your friends leave your life. It's a painful discovery, but it also can be a healing discovery when you find out that those who are truly friends come into your life. Esther struggled with this. She asked each time she came to worship, does God really care? Why did God let my beautiful son die? And she sometimes voiced those questions with anger and resentment and hurt. And I wonder about the place of worship, and I wonder about church. Is church, is worship, or our Christian relationships such that we allow people to ask hard, angry, painful, suffering questions and it doesn't scare us? We're not afraid of hard, painful questions. Isn't that the kind of people you think maybe God is calling us to be? Because life is filled with suffering, and we need friends to help us cope with that. Don't you want to be that kind of friend? Others in the synagogue had said to Esther, whatever happens is God's will. But she knew that could not be so. And so that day in the synagogue when Jesus took the scroll and unrolled it and read the scripture lesson, it was one of his very favorite ones, and it seemed like he read it often, because you'll hear of it in other places other than here in Mark's gospel. He read that passage in Isaiah where it is said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free, to announce the favorable year of the Lord." And when she heard that morning, Esther knew this was the message her son would have understood and affirmed, and that he would have found someone to follow, someone whose teaching had integrity along with authority. A scribe, a teacher of the law named Reuben, heard Jesus teaching in his synagogue that day too. As he listened and observed this stranger teaching, the pain, the excitement of the gathered congregation was obvious to him, painfully obvious. Well, how would you feel if someone were invited to your church and you were the pastor or the preacher, and this person got up to preach, and guess what? She was a whole lot better than you were. She likely is. Reuben had heard after his teaching usually just a few platitudes. "Reuben, we could hear every word you spoke today. We could hear it crystal clear." But what Reuben never really heard was anything about the content, the meaning, the substance of what he had to say, and how it might change or transform life, call people to want to go out into the world with their bodies and do something to make things different. That he never heard. And the children, when they left worship each and every Sunday, they would wave at him and smile, but he knew they didn't especially like or love him, because most of all, they feared him. All around him, Reuben heard and saw how amazed everyone was with this Jesus and his teaching. He overheard whispers, "This Jesus teaches with authority, not like the scribes," and that cut him to the very quick. "Didn't they know," Reuben said to himself, "that religious leaders who stir the pot, who point out the difference between the way things are and the way things should be, are only going to get in trouble?" Isn't that true? If we're told the gap between the way things are and the way God wishes them to be, I don't know about you, but that kind of stirs me up a little bit. You mean I have to change some? Sometimes that's not very easy, is it? Reuben knew this Jesus fellow was stirring the pot. Did he really think the purpose of religion is to transform people and to change the world? Is that what he really thinks? There was another there that day keenly observing this new teacher. It was the man with an unclean spirit. He was possessed by this evil spirit. Now, we're modern people here, I assume, here in a university town. Maybe you don't believe in evil spirits. Would I be right for some of us at least? Maybe we don't believe in the presence of evil in our world. I'm not sure how we can ignore that. When C.S. Lewis, the great Christian writer and British leader of some years ago, was asked, C.S. Lewis was asked if he believed in the devil. Did he believe in the presence of evil in the world? And Lewis, in his typical fashion, thought about it a moment, and he said, "Well, I'm not particular about the hoofs and the horns, but in other respects, yes, I do believe there's evil in the world." I've been around long enough to have encountered it, and I'm sure you have, and sometimes evil in the world comes in the appearance of someone in a three-piece suit. Very decorous, very polished, but we all know there is evil to confront. Strangely, this man with the unclean spirit had never felt threatened in the synagogue. Actually, it had felt quite safe there. He enjoyed it because it was a friendly group of people who found it kind of difficult to tell people to behave when they were not behaving particularly well. It's hard for us church people at times to do that. He'd go there, look for opportunities to create trouble and dissension. It wasn't hard. People had itching ears, and it wasn't all that difficult to sow seeds of distrust to turn neighbor against neighbor. But life changed that day when this new teacher came into the synagogue and taught as one with authority, because when he was just getting ready to take over things one more time, the teacher said, "Silence, silence." A boundary was drawn. And Jesus told him, this kind of behavior, evil and destructive as it is no longer tolerated here. I wonder, what would we do? How, in fact, will we face evil in this world? Much later on, this same man would hear how Jesus' opponents would accuse him of having gone out of his mind. And if you read later on the gospel stories, you'll realize that Jesus' own mother and brothers and sisters, actually, when they saw what he was about, came one day as an intervention committee to tell Jesus he needed to come home because he was stirring things up too much and he was only going to get into trouble. It's the way we sometimes deal with those who would wish us, when Jesus would wish us to change. First of all, we'll tell a prophet that they're unrealistic. Am I right? You're rather naive. Things really can't change that fast or that quickly. And then if that doesn't work, we'll tell them that they're causing trouble. And then finally, if that doesn't work, we call them crazy. We marginalize them. And Jesus was that way. But there in the synagogue that day, the man with the unclean spirit received healing as his own evil and self-destruction was challenged. And long after, he remembered the prayer Jesus also taught him then and his disciples later. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done here on earth. And then that wonderful part of the prayer that always caught him each and every time, deliver us from evil. People of Oxford Presbyterian Church, how are we responding to Jesus' call to confront evil and suffering in the world? What do you think Jesus wants us to do? What does Jesus have to do with us? There are all kinds of questions we can ask about the purpose of the church and why we are church together. But I would say the question that lingers that we need to keep asking and talking about is this: what does Jesus want to do with you and with me and with us together in this time and place? Freely we have received of God's goodness and grace, let us freely share. According to the Gospel of Luke, they will come from east and west and north and south and sit at table in the kingdom of God. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is his table, and he invites all those who trust him and seek to follow him to come to this table. May the God of wondrous deeds be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to our God.
We lift our whole hearts to God, holding nothing back.
Join in praising God, who is merciful and gracious.
In the company of our friends and fellow followers, we rejoice in the one who is our God.
Holy are you, awesome Creator, and blessed is Jesus Christ, Redeemer of all. He teaches as one with authority those who rebel against you. He heals as one with compassion those who struggle with pain and illness. He calls as one with the words of life those who have lost their way. He dies as one with complete trust for those who have no hope. He rises as one known by God so we may live with you. And so as we remember what Jesus has done for us, as we celebrate his life, death, and resurrection, we speak of that mystery we know as faith, saying together, Christ died as we fell silent in grief. Christ is raised, silencing the power of sin and death. Christ fills the silence of our fears with songs of your wondrous love and life. You long to have everything to do with us, God of wonders, and so you call us to this table of peace, hope, reconciliation. Here in the bread and in the cup transformed by your Spirit, we are reminded that there is no God but you. For in the life of the bread, we feast on that grace which can heal a broken world. For in the sweet taste of the cup's hope, we taste those promises which we can share with all people. Peace where there is only war, love where there is only evil, wonder where there is only despair. For from you come all things. To you we all would turn to follow. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. According to the Apostle Paul, our Lord gathered in an upper room with his disciples. And there he took bread after he blessed and broke it, and he raised it to heaven, saying, "This is my body given for you." In the same way, at that table in the upper room, our Lord took a cup and said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." The Apostle Paul reminds us that as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the living, risen Christ as he seeks to come again more fully into our lives and world, the gifts of God for the people of God. I would invite the elders to come forward to serve the people of God. Just one to the choir, and then this one. You're invited to come forward to eat the bread, drink the cup, and be nourished by Christ's presence and love.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the bread of heaven come down to feed us, to nurture us, so that none need go away hungry. Help us to imagine a world where no one goes away hungry. In your name we pray and give thanks. Amen. I'd like to invite you to share some joys and concerns. And I'll begin this way, if I may, Joy. Last Sunday, I spoke to Paul Russell for the last time. Paul died this past Monday after treatment for heart issues. Paul died doing what he loved. Last Sunday afternoon, he was preparing to teach a class, something he had great passion for, helping people to understand the Bible and faith and how it all fits into our lives. I am deeply saddened, Joy, deeply. But, you know, what a wonderful way to be engaged in life, doing the thing you felt some passion about. We want you to know we love you. We want you to know, as so many have said as well, we love Paul. I had great plans for Paul, a gifted teacher. But, you know, he taught with some authority and integrity too. And the lessons he taught his friends and family and others, those things can endure. And we are grateful and give thanks for Paul. As I understand, a service of celebration for his life is next Sunday afternoon at the Knolls. And there is much to celebrate in his life. God bless you and your family. Are there other joys and concerns we would share together this day? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Other joys and/or concerns? How about for our youth and our youth ministry who are learning about the Super Bowl of caring? If memory serves me, and I think it does, I don't think I've reached the point yet where I'm losing it, but I think Presbyterians years ago in a youth group in South Carolina first initiated the celebration of Super Bowl of caring on Sunday. Isn't it good to know Presbyterians are imaginative of thinking such ways to make a difference? And these youth in South Carolina began something that has spread all across the country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Other joys and concerns, Prue. Wow. When you were still in the youth group. Okay. What a wonderful thing to celebrate. Mickey and I have spoken about her sister and John with concerns about the Woodruff's health, and we want you to know, and they also, that we are praying for them, Mickey. Lord, in your mercy. Are there other joys and concerns? Yes, Kent.
Then my heart.
Let's give Georgia. We in the choir have been entertaining the thought of making him an honorary Presbyterian. And he says he's going to have that put on his luggage. We love you, George. Other joys and concerns? Debbie. Prayer of gratitude. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you. And also thanks for so many people in the life of this congregation who visit folks in their homes and in the hospital, deacons and others, and for those who serve in teaching in our church school, and those who are about to say yes to hosting a Lenten spirituality group. There's some of you that the Spirit is now speaking to, even as I speak, and you're saying, yes, I'd like to convene and host a group. I can already sense that in the group. Lord, in your mercy. Any others? Cal.
For you, Hart, and the kind of task that you are chosen to do and your tremendous work here at the Oxford
Presbyterian Church. Amen.
He's a pretty sweet fellow there. Well, any others? Let us close. Gracious God, you are present with us even when we are not always fully present to you. But we know you keep coming again and again and again. And when we ask, what do you have to do with us? You say, I am here to love you and to invite you into a loving, serving relationship with me. This is the passion I have for you. In your name we pray a joyful prayer of thanksgiving. Amen. Let us stand and sing together. And now go out into the world in peace, be of good courage, return to no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the suffering, honor everyone, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord. And now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit strengthen you all, both now and forever.